Good evening and welcome to another edition of the Yuba Sutter Medical Explorer. My name is Dr. Robert Peppercorn and my specialty is dermatology. I serve as host of this program. The purpose of the Medical Explorer is to explore the medical communities of Yuba and Sutter counties and to take you behind the scenes of medical care practices in our local area. We have another interesting program for you tonight as we explore the world of veterinary medicine. Our Channel 5 cameras will take us into the office of one of our area's leading veterinarians, and we will watch him provide medical care for several of his very interesting patients. Before getting to our topic tonight, let's take a look at the latest medical news. A new form of treatment for sufferers of chronic back pain has been developed at the University of Wisconsin. This new treatment uses injections of a substance from papaya trees instead of surgery. About 4,000 people suffering from slipped discs have undergone treatment with an enzyme called chymopapaine, since it gained governmental approval in November. Injected directly into a slipped or hardened disc, the enzyme causes the disc to soften and return to its normal position. The treatment has had 90% success in relieving chronic pain for up to 6 months in over 100 patients. About 200,000 people a year undergo surgery for slipped discs, while 95% of the 8 million people who suffer slipped discs each year get better with bed rest, special exercises, and aspirin alone. Switching to another medical news story, we know that most doctors strongly urge their patients to quit smoking. But did you know that most also take their own advice very seriously? Of 613 doctors attending the American Lung Association meeting in Kansas City, 96% say they keep reminding their patients who do smoke to quit. 30% took their own advice and did quit, and only 5% of the doctors say they still smoke cigarettes. Smoking is still the single greatest cause of disease and death in the United States. In our final news story tonight, women who use estrogen to combat adverse effects of menopause do not increase their risk of breast cancer, according to a new study from the Center of Disease Control in Atlanta. The study, the largest ever done on the possible relationship between breast cancer and estrogen, found that breast cancer is not higher in women who take supplemental estrogen pills. Now, on with the Medical Explorer. Did you know that the number of household pets in the United States is greater than the number of children? Veterinary medicine is the field of healthcare that deals with the illnesses that affect our animals and pets. I've been looking forward to tonight's program for quite some time, because I've never had the opportunity to venture behind the scenes of a veterinarian's office. Well, tonight, we will all get the chance to see a veterinarian at work. Let's head over to Marysville and explore the Marysville Veterinary Hospital. Today, we're in the office of Dr. Ronald Ringen, veterinarian in Marysville. We're at the Marysville Veterinary Hospital today. And Dr. Ringen is going to show us what actually goes on behind the scenes in a veterinary medicine practice. Our first patient today was brought in by a lady stating that her dog wasn't acting like it used to. The dog was acting a little bit run down, acting like an old dog, even though the dog isn't very old. So let's go over to Dr. Ringen's examining area and actually see what he would do in the case of this dog that doesn't seem to be acting the way it should.
Well, we have with us a patient who is not does not have the stamina, the energy level that she should have. She's not a very old dog, but she acts like an old dog. So what we'd like to do is examine her and try and determine what is going on. First of all, I like to look at her general overall condition, the color of her eyes and the inside of her mouth, make sure that if there's something going on that would interfere with breathing, we could detect that. But she seems like she is in basically good health. We will listen to her chest and her heart. Well, there are some loud sounds that aren't quite normal. One thing that we have in this area that's not found all over the country is heartworms. Heartworms is a disease that's transmitted by the mosquito, and I'm sure everybody has been exposed to mosquitoes in the last month. This area has had mosquitoes for many years, and heartworm has been a problem, but in the last 6 or 7 years, it's almost has reached epidemic proportions in California. So we like to do a blood test for the heartworm disease as a routine test in these dogs that aren't feeling up to par. Cindy, would you help hold off the vein, and we'll pull a blood sample. Now, with the blood sample, we have to take just a small quantity, but we can run this through a filter. And the filter will filter out the organisms that are circulating in the bloodstream.
That sure was easy, getting that sample. You don't have to struggle finding the vein like we do on people.
Well, if the dog is relaxed and easygoing, then it's easy. But sometimes we have to fight them. But if you do them all day long.
True. The more you do. Where is the heart on a dog? I don't even know that exactly.
Of course, it's just at the point of the elbow. If you were to move the elbow back, that's about where the heart is located.
Oh, I see.
And of course, in heartworm disease, even though the worms are found in the heart, most of the damage is done to the lung tissue. So, of course, you want to listen to all of the lung tissue to try and find areas that are involved. Now, she was a very good patient, so that was easy. Now we'll allow this blood to sit here for 10 minutes. It'll destroy the red blood cells but leave the organisms intact. Then we'll put it through this filter, stain it, and then we can identify the microfilaria. And that's how we test for heartworm in this area.
What would you do if you found heartworm?
The next step is that tells us that she has adult worms in the heart. So then we have to treat her for the adult worms. That takes a series of 4 to 6 injections of an arsenic product. They have to be hospitalized. We do various lab tests to make sure that the kidneys are functioning properly, that the liver hasn't been damaged because of the lung tissue damage. See, when one thing starts, everything else starts breaking down afterwards. If we can determine that she can handle the treatment, then we hospitalize her, usually for a week to 10 days, give her the treatment, watch this, keep her from going into shock or mainly shock from the treatment, and then after 7 to 10 days, we send them home. Now, the microfilaria are still in the bloodstream. We just have killed the adults.
Oh,
yeah,
okay.
We've just killed the adults. In 6 weeks, then we treat her with another medication to kill the microfilaria that's in the capillaries, in the bloodstream. Then we test her again a couple of weeks later, and if everything is negative, if there are no microfilaria, then we feel that she's responded to the treatment. Then we put her on preventative medicine, and every day this dog should be on some medication to protect her from the heartworms. And that's pennies a day compared to the cost of treatment, which can be quite substantial.
Is that arsenic also?
No, it isn't.
Oh.
It's something that's not toxic and they can handle in great quantities, but it does protect them, does an excellent job of protecting them. Well, Roscoe sniffed something up his nose, and we have a suspicion that it's a foxtail. We have a lot of dry foxtails out in the fields right now, and Roscoe has the run of the ranch. So we'll give...
What exactly is a foxtail?
Foxtail is a plant on. The seed with the long... we call it the on. I don't know the proper term, but it has a reverse barb. So once it goes in, it doesn't come out. It just keeps going in.
It's like a fish hook that's in there, and you keep
right. So they snuff them up their nose. They get them in their eyes. They get them in their ears, between their toes. They just create a tremendous amount of damage. So we'll give Roscoe a very ultra short acting anesthetic, because the nose is so sensitive. They just do not like to have things probed in their nose. Now, it'll take a minute or so for Roscoe to respond or react. Sure, yeah, that didn't feel real good, but it's not the worst thing. It'll get that foxtail out. Well, Roscoe is now sedated to the point where I think we can probe the nose and hopefully locate the source of his sneezing. Now, sometimes it takes quite a while to find the little rascals. Oops, there I see it. Oh, boy. Now if I can keep from nicking the membranes, here we go. Look at that. Isn't that a beauty? That's a foxtail, Dr. Peppercorn. Look at that thing. Now you see, now you know what a foxtail is. Now we always look in both nostrils because sometimes they'll snuff up not only one, but more than one in each nostril. Yesterday we took one out of a boxer's nose and looked in the other nose, the other side of the nose, and there was another one. Well, it looks very, this side looks clean. I'll double check over here. Now's the time to get them out when they're sedated. Yeah, Roscoe, I think you're all right. Now while Roscoe's here, since that was a foxtail, I will also check the ears and do a routine exam, make sure there are no other problems. That one's okay. Oh yeah, what do you know? I think there is a little seed down in there. Maybe I'll find something else. Nope, just dry wax. Yeah, we're okay.
Dr. Ringen and his staff certainly did an outstanding job tonight demonstrating several areas of veterinary medical care. When we return, we will meet again with Dr. Ringen and discuss more interesting frontiers about health care for animals and learn more about the career of veterinary medicine.
Local television shines on cable channels.